ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله هيا على الصلاة هيا على الصلاة هيا على الفلاح هيا على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد قال الإمام أبو داود رحمه الله تعالى في سننه حدثنا أحمد بن يونس قال حدثنا ابن ذئب عن الحارث بن عبد الرحمن عن أبي سلمة عن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال لعن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الراشي والمرتشي أو بهذا المعنى والحديث أخرجه الإمام الترمذي وابن ماجه وإسناده لا بأس به Indeed, all praises are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, we mention Allah's beautiful names and perfect attributes. We invoke Him. We supplicate to Him. We call out to Him. We laud Him. We seek His aid. We seek His assistance. We seek His guidance. We seek His forgiveness. We seek His kind mercy and His gentle compassion. We seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's endless tolerance, His kindness to His servants, His forbearance upon our transgressions. Not transgression, transgressing the boundaries once, making a mistake once, but our transgressions, daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, and so many different aspects of our worship and our servitude to Him. Shortcomings, flaws, and times in which we just go beyond the limit and we don't stop as servants. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the evil and ugly things that we're capable of doing to ourselves and to each other. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us and not allow us to face the consequences of our misdeeds, our poor decisions, our actions that could have been more thought out, our actions in which we could have been a little more patient, our actions that were driven by impulse, driven by lust, driven by insecurity, driven by rage, driven by anger and jealousy, and we could have done better. We could have done better. It was in our ability as humans, as Muslims, as slaves, we had the ability to do a better job. We could have thought it out a little better, a little more, 5 more minutes, 10 more minutes, 1 more week, 1 more month, but we didn't. And we made the wrong decision. We made a misdeed. We made a mistake. We ask Allah to protect us from our sins catching up with us And it protects us from seeing the consequences of those mistakes and of those errors. Those who are guided is because Allah, the Mighty and the Most High, has made them so. And those who are misled is because Allah Azza wa Jalla did not choose to guide them. I bear witness and I testify that Allah, along without any partner, deserves to be worshipped, the only one true God. And I bear witness and I testify that Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, is the servant of Allah, the messenger of Allah, and he is the deliverer of the great news. He's a warner, and he's one who brings glad tidings. He's one who makes people smile and laugh, and other people, they will frown, and they will cry, and they will have long faces eventually. If not in this life, then definitely in the hereafter. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to his own companions, his own sahaba, لو تعلمون ما علموا لبكيتم كثيرا ولضحكتم قليلا أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you knew what I knew, you would laugh less and you would cry more. If you saw what I saw, you wouldn't laugh as much, you wouldn't smile as much, you would cry more. If you only knew what I know, and if you only shown and given what I have been shown and what I have been given. So the Prophet ﷺ is Bashir. He gives glad tidings, makes people happy and smile, makes people feel good. He unites, he unifies, he establishes, he builds, he structures, he erects things. He brings glad tidings, he brings good news. And the Prophet ﷺ was a warner. He warned us and he warned his people. And his words that are preserved in the hadith, they are his warnings to anyone who will hear them. وَأُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ لِأُنذِرَكُمْ بِهِ وَمَنْ بَلَغَ. Allah says, and this Quran has been given to me. Allah says, he tells us that the Prophet is to say, وَأُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ. This Quran has been given to me, it's been revealed to me. لِأُنذِرَكُمْ, for me to warn you. وَمَنْ بَلَغَ, and whoever the Quran reaches. May the prayers of Allah Azza wa Jalla be upon the Prophet. May Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with his companions, his household, his family members, his children and his wives, and all of the righteous believers to proceed. We have so many problems in the world today, brothers and sisters. Problems in the world today. Problems of different categories, different levels, different types. Problems in different locations around the world, globally. We have problems with regards to religion. Problems with regards to spirituality. We have problems with regards to finance and economics. So many human beings, the majority of the population, living in abject poverty, living in a standard that is beneath that which is basic for any human being to live. For any human being to live. We have so many problems with regards to morality, with regards to character, with regards to conduct, how we behave, how we conduct ourselves, how the people in the world today, the things that they do, the things that they say. And we also have problems with regards to leadership. And we have problems with regards to subjects. Those who are in charge, there are problems. And those who are to support the leader, behind the leader, there are problems. There are problems with regards to one's family, with regards to one's marriage, with regards to divorce, with regards to custody. There are so many problems in the society today. So many ills. There's no doubt about that. And from the greatest reasons behind these global problems, and these worldwide problems, and worldwide suffering, is that which is called bribery. Bribery, giving bribes and taking bribes. Giving them and taking them. إِعْطَاءُ مَالٍ لِإِبْطَالِ حَقٍ أَوْ لِإِحْقَاقِ بَاطِلٍ. It's to give money, a little, a lot, an envelope, a box, money, wealth, possession, to falsify someone's right, to negate them of what they deserve, what is theirs rightfully, according to religion, according to spirituality, according to politics, according to the law, according to the civil rights, or the opposite. Someone doesn't deserve a thing. They're not suited for a thing. They're not qualified for a thing. I give money, you give money, I grease a palm, I wet someone's beak, and now they are mustahiq. Now they deserve that position, that status, that authority. They deserve that right that they had no right getting. And due to the fact that bribery is so dangerous, it is so ruinous to the threads of society, to the threads of religion, to the threads of spirituality, because of that, Islam has taken the staunchest and most rigid position against it. Islam has never ever shown any leniency to any type of offering or giving that's financial. To give someone something that they do not deserve, or to take something away from someone that they actually do deserve. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with them both, that you can find in the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawud, in the Jami' of Imam Tirmidhi, in the Sunan of Imam Ibn Majah, and the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, with a good chain of narration. La'ana Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ar-rashi wal-murtashi. Allah's Messenger cursed, doomed, and damned he who gives a bribe, wal-murtashi, and he who accepts the bribe. La'ana Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ar-rashi wal-murtashi. The Messenger of Allah has cursed, doomed, and damned anyone who gives anything for one of those two objectives. لِإِبْطَالِ حَقْ. Someone deserves a thing, here, take this. Don't give them what they deserve. Or don't do what's necessary. Don't make the necessary check or investigation or stopping, etc., etc. Only إِحْقَاقِ حَقٍ or إِحْقَاقِ بَطْلٍ. To make the opposite as well. So he who gives this money, she who pays this money, regardless of the reason, regardless of the situation, regardless of how small and how minute it may be, black lie, white lie, matters not. Giving rishwa, giving bribery. And he who takes the bribery, well, I didn't kill anyone, I didn't steal anything, I didn't fail this person, I didn't put them into the school or the position or to the college, I just took the envelope and turned a blind eye. I didn't do anything wrong to anyone, I have to make a living, I have to feed my family. La'ana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ar-rashi wal-murtashi. The eater and the one who supplies it, they are cursed. And this is very similar to another authentic hadith, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, and he explains to us that the curse of Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam invoked the curse of Allah upon what? أكل الربا ومُكِلَه. He who eats the riba, who gets it, who receives the envelope or the package or the box, ومُكِلَه. And he who says, this is for your family, this is a gift for you, official, judge, officer, imam, sheikh, brother, sister, inshallah ta'ala, please remember my son, please remember me, please such and such. Or even without saying anything, you know someone is of a status, of position, and they have a responsibility to have blind and naked justice. Blind and naked justice. I look at facts and information, nothing more. Your skin color, your tribe, where you come from, your family, it doesn't matter. Only investigation, facts. So you give this person an envelope, you don't say anything, you smile. That which is known doesn't always have to be said. And from this reason, or from this principle, the scholars of Islam, they established a maxim, a qaida, a grand maxim. And that is, إِنَّ الْمَعْرُوفِ يَجْرِي مَجْرَ الْمَشْرُوطِ. That which is known and silent is just like that which is stipulated. That which is known, but it isn't uttered, it isn't said, but it's known. It takes the same course and the same path of that which is actually stipulated. So take this money and get my son off. Take this money and get my daughter into this school. Or I go to the dean, the president, and I give him an expensive gift and I say anything. I say nothing. Everybody knows we're both adults. We know what the envelope is for. We know what the car is for. We know what the money is for. We know what the gift is for. So this is impermissible. It's a major sin. As the Prophet ﷺ said, or the hadith says, la'ana, he cursed. And any hadith in which the word curse is mentioned, is automatically a major sin and is automatically impermissible. Both of them. It's not makruh, there's no difference of opinion. It's haram and is a major destructive sin. So the Prophet ﷺ, he cursed these people. He invoked Allah against these people. Why? What's so bad about bribes? What's so bad about bribery? What does it do to the people, to the society, to the religion, to the center, to the home? What happens when you give a bribe? There are countless harms and many ruinous, destructive things included in bribery. And from that, first and foremost, is destruction of one's faith. Destruction of iman. And that's because bribery is impermissible, as we have quoted. And secondly, you are a leader. You are a captain. You are an imam. You're a president. You're in charge of the people. Allah gave you a responsibility. Allah gave you a duty. And you turn a blind eye to your duty and your responsibility, you have disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah commanded you to be just, and Allah commanded you to do what you're in charge of doing. So the moment you neglect that, you have disobeyed Allah Azza wa Jal twice. First and foremost is in not fulfilling the responsibility. And secondly, in the specifics of taking the bribery, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, and we all know that the Quran teaches us, is that whoever obeys the messenger, فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهُ. Whoever obeys the messenger, he's obeyed Allah in reality. Whoever has obeyed the hadith of the Prophet is obeying the Quran. Whoever listens to the Prophet's words, he's following Allah's words. This is what the Quran says. So this is the first problem with a bribe. Number two, bribery causes the eternal caste system of rich, wealthy, strong, powerful versus poor, weak, and trodden upon. You can never ever win, not through courts, not through the religion, not through the mosque, and that's because these people, they're paying me, they're supplying me, they're giving me money that you can't give. So it matters not what evidence you have, what proof you have. It matters not how many people are hurt and destroyed and ruined. The person never bites the hand that feeds him. So therefore, it is men from the concept of continuing the jahiliyyah of the people. And that is that I'm higher than you, I'm better than you, and I'm above you, and that's how things will remain. And look here at the differences or the parallels between this and riba. They go hand in hand. And that is riba keeps the rich rich and keeps the poor poor. If I had the money to pay interest on a debt, I wouldn't have to ask for a debt. So due to the fact that I'm asking you for money, please loan me money, proves that I don't have the money. So I have to pay back the money, humiliate myself by asking, and pay interest. So the person, obviously, the wealthy person and the rich person, he's not being harmed by loaning the money out. It's not harming him because that money is in his bank account. That money is sitting to the side. There's other investments, other assets. It doesn't bother him. It doesn't harm him. So he remains rich. You have to pay back in full and you have to pay more. And the moment that you're late and you can't pay, then it's more and it's more and it increases and it never ever stops. And the moment the chain and the ball is placed on your wrist and your ankle, you're never ever set free. And what happens? Why is that so bad? The rich person remains filthy rich. And the poor people and the needy people, they remain poor and needy. And it is systematic dhulm through bribes. Point number three, taking bribes, giving bribes, it destroys morality. It destroys a person's moral character. It destroys his soul, in which he becomes extremely greedy and he has an insatiable taste for wealth. And he doesn't care about people, their feelings, their needs, and their rights. And that leads us to the fourth harm, which is the lack of sympathy and the lack of empathy. It doesn't matter. It's not personal. It's business. It doesn't matter who's guilty. It doesn't matter who's innocent. It doesn't matter who deserves to go. It's all about money because money makes the world go round. And the world is fueled and ran by the great grand dollar bill. That destroys a person's morality and it causes him only to think about himself and only to look at himself and to neglect the need and the want of the next individual. And of course, this in Islam is like water and oil. These things don't mix. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, to show us how they don't mix, how so much so, is that he negated faith for those who have no sympathy and no compassion. You don't believe, you cannot be a believer unless you love for your brother what you love for yourself. And that's called what? Sympathy and compassion, relating to your brother. You know what? It's mine, but here I want you to have it. Because I know how it feels when I don't have much. I know how it feels when I'm needy. I know how it feels when I need something. So these are some of the harms of bribes. And the destruction of a city, a state, a country, and the destruction of a masjid, and the destruction of any congregation or social gathering. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect the Muslims from bribes and bribery. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu Allahi wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa amma ba'd. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, in many of his authentic hadiths, he explains to us the nature of money and the nature of wealth and the nature of material gain and material possessions and the nature of this worldly life. And from those hadiths is what the Prophet ﷺ says, "Inna dunya hulwatun khadiratun." He says, and indeed this worldly life has two characteristics, two traits, two qualities. It is sweet and it's green. It tastes good and it's pleasing to the eyes. It tastes good, hulwatun. It's good to have, and it's also good to look at. حُلْوَةٌ خَضِرَةٌ وَإِنَّ رِجَالًا يَتَخَوَّضُونَ فِي مَالِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, and there are men out there, men, they exist in the world, men of evil, They play around with Allah's money. They grab, they snatch, they put, they take, they yatakhawwadun. They play around with the money that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bi ghayri haq, unjustly. فَلَهُمَ النَّارُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And that is why they will have the fire on the day of judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in another authentic hadith, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فِتْنَةٌ وَفِتْنَةُ أُمَّةِ الْمَالِ. For every nation there's a major obsession, a major trial, and a major means of infatuation. As far as that of my ummah, then it is money. Money, money, money. A person will believe and disbelieve because of money. A person will be just or unjust because of money. A person will turn a blind eye and say, it doesn't concern me, it's not my business, because of money. And here in the United States, we should know very well about bribes and bribery. Great scandals in history, and the great scandals with regards to colleges and universities. Kids that are privileged, that go to certain schools, Ivy League schools, that don't have the necessary intelligence, don't have the necessary grades, don't have the necessary hard work, and they go to those schools, and they get admitted to those schools at the expense of those who actually deserve the scholarships because of what? Because of bribes. And this is no secret. This is public information. Many, many prominent people have been exposed, embarrassed, and humiliated because they paid bribes to get their children in better, higher schools. They had greed. And it doesn't matter about this child, your marks, your grades. You stood up all night for the test. You studied for 2-3 months. It doesn't matter. My son deserves your place in that university because of money. So bribery is evil. And from that which is happening in the world today, around the globe, and in the United States, there lies no doubt that bribery plays a pivotal role. A pivotal role. There are doctors who are paid and bribed to give false information about the pandemic. False numbers, exaggerated numbers. People are dying from the normal average flu. People are dying from other complications and health issues. It's a COVID case. We need the numbers to swell. We need the panic to continue. We need the people to suffer. We need to strangle them into submission. And then they'll do whatever we want them to do. And if you don't believe this, look at a lab rat. Or look at a monkey in a cage. They'll prevent the lab rat from eating, from drinking, from seeing the other rats in the tank. And then when they want the lab rat to do what they want to do, they'll let it back into the congregation. And if you refuse to jump in the loop or drink this or do this, then you go back into seclusion. And look how anxious the small, tiny, poor animal becomes because of the dhulm. And is literally forced into submission, is forced into surrender. Everyone understand how this works? So this is a reality with regards to what's going on around in the world today. People being paid to give false information. People being fed to exaggerate numbers or to keep quiet about other aspects of the pandemic. And with regards to police brutality, and with regards to people being shot in the street and choked and strangled, and people being harmed and wronged by the law enforcement, bribery plays a pivotal role as well. And that is because, first and foremost, this police officer has no business being a police officer. His record, his training, his background, he has no business walking around with a loaded gun. He has no business walking around with a taser and a nightstick and handcuffs. He has no business in that position of authority. But there is the package. That's my son, that's my cousin, that's my nephew. Get him in. And also those who do break the law and violate the law, and those people who are extremely brutal to people who do not deserve their brutality, they get, at best, a slap on the wrist. Why do you think the judge says not guilty? Or third-degree murder, manslaughter, instead of clear first-degree murder? You killed someone in cold blood. Because of what? Because of bribery. The people that are going out protesting, looting, destroying property, are all of them fighting for the same cause? Are those people from that neighborhood? Is this person from this town? Or have they been paid and bribed by other people to destroy and then let the other people take the blame for it? So bribes, giving money, taking money, receiving money to destroy the truth, to cover up facts, to hinder proper investigations, bribes to get people off who are red, they're caught red-handed, dead guilty, is evil. And that is why the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has warned us. And one of the reasons why many undeveloped countries, or quote-unquote third world countries, are so underdeveloped and so third world, is because the widespread of corruption. And bribery is the immediate gateway to corruption. It's the immediate gateway to corruption. Poor medical system because of bribes. Someone scores a 100 on the medical exam. He doesn't get the job as the top physician because of a bribe. And someone who barely knows a scalpel from a butter knife. He gets the job as the top position because of bribery. With regards to oppressive systems of court, oppressive judges, oppressive lawyers, oppressive prosecutors, false and fake witnesses. Through what? Through money. With regards to police, law enforcement, with regards to the infrastructure of the city, why is the road so poor? Why aren't there any traffic lights? Why does the electricity cut off at 2 a.m. every night? There's no electricity in the country. There's no natural gas here. There's no gold. There's no rice. There's no lumber. There's no resources in this country in South America. In Central America, there's no resources here because of corruption. And corruption goes hand in hand with bribes. Keep these people silent. Keep them down. Keep them low through bribery. Corrupt officials will remain. And just officials who wish to stand up for justice, they will be pushed and moved out the way through money. And also when it comes to drugs and drug abuse and substance abuse and drug smuggling and drug trafficking, how do you think the drugs get into the country? How do you think the drugs leave the country? How do you think the drugs are, they make their way into a boat and a car or TV or a refrigerator or a carpet or a rug or a can of tomato sauce through nothing else but bribes? The official turns the blind eye, he looks away, and he allows it to move forward. How many people are going to suffer from that boatload of heroin? How many families are going to be destroyed? How many mothers and fathers? How much chaos and havoc and mayhem will be through that one shipment of cocaine that makes it to the United States from Peru or from Bolivia because of bribery? With regards to sex trafficking, taking people as slaves, selling little kids to sick, twisted, demented, powerful men and women, how do you think they leave the country and come to this country? How do you think they make it through the borders? How do you think they get on the boat? How do you think they make it on an airplane? Through what? Through bribes. Through people giving wealth and paying off the officials. And we can go on and on and on about the destruction and the ruin of bribes in one's religion and one's spirituality, one's character, one's morality, and in our society. Nothing is an accident and nothing is a mistake. Nothing is an accident and nothing is a mistake. This third world country is not a country that lacks resources. It's not a country that's short on natural things. It has an abundance. Rather, the first world country, the main developed country, is nothing without those resources, whether it be fruit, whether it be gas, whether it be other things. And one of the reasons why it's like that is because of the systematic bribery and the systematic corruption. So therefore, Islam does not take an easy, simple, lazy stance with regards to those who give bribes and those who take bribes. If you have taken a bribe, then make repentance. If you have given it, then make repentance. If you were forced and you had no other option, then inshallah, hopefully there's no sin upon you. But do not give in that easily. And every time you pass someone an envelope and you give someone a bribe, you give someone a friendly gift with invisible strings attached, know that that comes at the cost of 10 other families suffering, of 100 families suffering. That one bag of rice that you take illegally is a bag of rice for an entire village of people that won't have food tonight. And the list goes on of examples. The list goes on of problems and harms of this evil vice that we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to purify our country and to purify the entire world and to purify the Muslim lands and the Muslim countries from this evil thing. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us from bribes and for those who give them.